Well, as you know that I'm going to talk on Sankhya philosophy today. A very brief understanding of the concept of philosophy in India I've already given to you, that there are six orthodox systems and two heterodox systems, excluding the Charvak, which is also a heterodox system. So in all, there are nine philosophies. It's very interesting to understand and to know that out of these philosophies, you know, Jaina philosophy also considers Mahavir to be the God or something like that. In Buddha philosophy, of course, there is godless, but Buddha is considered to be God also. In Indian philosophy, orthodox systems, it is very unique to understand that Sankhya philosophy is a philosophy without the God, without even concept of Ishwar. So Sankhya is always said to be atheist philosophy, whereas all other philosophies are theist philosophy. Yoga is theist philosophy, it talks about Ishwara. Nyaya is theist philosophy. Vaisheshika is theist philosophy. Vedanta is undoubtedly a theist philosophy. So these are theist philosophy, whereas Sankhya stands without having any type of concept of God in it. And yet it is able to present itself. Every philosophy has a founder. About Patanjali's Yoga Sutra, that actually Patanjali was not the founder or originator of yoga. He was only systematizer of yoga. Unlike the other philosophers who were really founder of the system. Kapil was the founder of the system of Sankhya philosophy. He was the author of a book named Sankhya Sutra. But unfortunately, that book is not with us. We do not have any trace of that book. So far, we have only informed that yes, the book was known as Sankhya Sutra. The earliest book on Sankhya Sutra is written by Ishwar Krishna. And the book is named Sankhya Karika. And we have the only that particular oldest information about the Sankhya philosophy. However, Sankhya is being named and also presented in different other scriptures. If you read the Bhagavad Gita, you will find that Sankhya is named there. You read other scriptures, you will find even in Upanishads, we find the name of Sankhya. But the original book on Sankhya is not available. The original book, or the earliest original book that is presented to us, is named as Sankhya Karika, and it is written by Ishwar Krishna. And it is again a very small book. A small book of just 78 karikas. When I say karika, karika is usually of two sentences or two lines, just as a poem usually is having. So 78 karikas make it double. You can find that they are around 156 lines. And you can see that those 156 lines are so powerful that they present the philosophy in a very, very difficult form, not to be understood without the commentary. We can't understand the philosophy by reading only the Ishwar Krishna's 78 karikas. We will have to understand it through Guru. And that is the difference. That is what is the philosophy is. We cannot understand the philosophical expositions that is given by Ishwar Krishna through reading only the karikas. We have to read the commentary. So what I am explaining to you also is based on the commentary on Yoga Sutra, on Ishwar Krishna's Sankhya Karika. Now, we call it Sankhya philosophy. What exactly is the meaning of Sankhya? Sankhya has got two meanings. The two meaning is, one is Sankhya, you know, number. Sankhya is also known as number. In English, we call it number. In Hindi, we call it Sankhya. It is actually a book which enumerates the objects of the world. And when it enumerates the objects of the world, it is not enumerating the different combination permutations that are presented in modern times, it only presents to the point where the further in combination permutation is possible, but not mentioned. So ultimate at that point it stops where the further combination permutation is required. That is, for example, I am saying, if it talks about earth, water, fire, air and ether, earth, water, fire, air and ether is the final point where it stops. Now when you have to go further, you will find that every object is a combination and permutation of this earth, water, fire and ether. So no need to enumerate all those things. It stops its description only up to earth, water, fire, air and ether. But there is another meaning also assigned to it. And that another meaning is Sankhya. Sankhya also can be understood as Samkhya, right knowledge. This means that the word Sankhya is standing for giving you the right knowledge. Well, you know that the philosophy, if every Indian philosophy aims at getting right knowledge, because we are not having the knowledge now, and when we read the philosophy we will get the knowledge, and the right knowledge only can lead us to the highest goal, that is known as liberation. This Sankhya philosophy claims that by reading this Sankhya philosophy one can get the right knowledge and one can become free from coming again and again in this world, that is he can be liberated. And that's why it claims that it is the right knowledge. Sankhya philosophy is a philosophy of dualistic realism. I am saying realism because it accepts them as a reality. What is called reality in Indian philosophy? The reality means that which cannot be further eliminated, that remains, that is real, that is called Sat. So that which is really realistic. So when it says dualistic realism, it accepts the two objects to be maintaining and remaining always there, even in when there is completely nothing remains, but these two objects will remain forever, two realities. Suppose you may be familiar with the philosophy of Vedanta, which says Brahman is the only reality. According to Vedanta philosophy, all other things are not unreal. It is only Brahman which is real, because everything will be there, will be completely gone or completely, जिसको हम लोग कहते हैं कि जब प्रलय आ जाएगा, even in the प्रलय, after the प्रलय, what will remain? After the प्रलय, the remain will be, according to the Sankhya, two realities will always be there. So dualistic means it believes in two ultimate realities, and it names that one is called Purusha and other is called Prakriti. Well, I will be explaining what is Purusha and Prakriti, but for a very simple understanding, Prakriti is understood as matter and Purusha is understood as self or Atman. So, in other words, you can say that the whole world is a creation of combination of this self and matter. If you say this, our human body is a unique combination of matter and self both. It is not only self, it is not only matter. These are the two things. And very interestingly, Sankhya also further says that the self is not one. There are many selves. As many persons are here listening to me, they all are having the self. I am also having the self, and everybody, and all selves are independent according to the Sankhya. So there are many Purushas. They also equally emphasize on the existence of matter. Matter also exists. therefore it is said that it is a dualistic philosophy against pluralistic or monistic. Vedanta is a monistic philosophy which again accepts only one reality. And there are philosophies like that of Nyaya, Vaisheshika, Jaina, also the Mimamsa. They are called pluralistic philosophy because they have accepted many realities. They all exist even when there is complete pralaya. This is interesting that Sankhya first of all talks about the cause and effect relationship. It is said that because you know that we are seeing, we are the creation of somebody. Every object of the world is a creation. Everything has been created by somebody. Somebody is responsible for its creation. For me, my parents are responsible for my creation. For this particular water bottle, somebody else is responsible for its creation. There are many things, everything that you are seeing around, somebody is responsible for its creation. Now, who has created it? And what are the things through which it has been created? This has always disturbed the mind, and Sankhya has started talking on this, that if I am a creation, then there must be somebody who is responsible for my creation. This problem is further carried out to the point that there must be some cause for the birth in a particular family, in which family I have been born. There must be some reason behind. We see that somebody is rich, somebody is poor, and so on and so forth. In the course of this inquiry, they discuss the cause and effect theory. We are the effects. We are not the cause. We are cause for somebody, but we are fundamentally effects. And we may be the cause for several other things. I am cause for my children. But again, my children will accept me as cause for themselves. But who is the cause for me? Then they will be saying, okay, my grandfather, and go on behind, go back. Somewhere you have to stop. Who was the cause? Ultimate cause. And therefore, Indian philosophy clearly believes that whatever is happening to me in this world, there must be some cause behind this situation. It is not happening without any reason. There must be a cause behind whatever the situation we are undergoing. We are effect of certain cause. In order to find out a logical answer to this question, they are talking about cause and effect theory. Because unless we know from where we have come, who is the ultimate cause, how can we go back? Unless we know who is my cause. And therefore, they are trying to find out who is the ultimate cause for my existence in the world, for bringing me in this world. And they are trying to go back and trying to find out the ultimate cause. But finding ultimate cause is not so easy. Because when you want to find ultimate cause, you have to also take into consideration that such cause should have also the potentiality to bring me in this world. Anything cannot be considered as cause. And therefore, the cause and effect theory, they have accepted a very technical understanding, technical word for it, and it is called Satkaryavad. Satkaryavad is a very technical term. It says that in order to understand this cause and effect theory, they postulate the theory of Satkaryavad, meaning Sat means exists, Karj means effect, Vad means theory. Now, if you make a sentence from these three words, effect exists theory. Effect exists theory what? Where is it effects? Where it exists? So they have said that effect exists in its cause prior to its production. See, I am a production, or I am the effect of my parents. parents had the potentiality to bring me in this world, before I took birth, there was the potentiality in my parents. In the same way, every object which has taken birth in this world has come from it some potential cause. So effect exists in its cause prior to its production. That is the theory known as Satkaryavad. We shall see it in detail, in little detail. Just try to understand it. I am trying to make it more clear. You know that all Indian philosophy, all the schools of Indian philosophy accept or have talked about the cause and effect. They started with the cause as earth, water, fire and ether. These are the cause. And because of that earth, water, fire and ether, we have come in this world. So earth, water, fire and ether are potentially having the ability to produce the different objects. In this way, the Satkaryavad has got, or cause and effect theory has got three types of interpretation. They give three theories. Two of the theories are known as Satkaryavad, and one of the theory is known as Arambhavad. Well, try to understand again further. That I told you that the Sankhya philosophy accepts two ultimate realities. One of them is Prakriti, other is Purusha. They think, and they have not only tried to prove, but they have established Prakriti is the root cause of our production in this, or of the world of effects. Everything has come from Prakriti. And it is known as, this Satkaryavad is known as Prakriti Parinamavad. Prakriti Parinamavad means the real transformation of cause into effect. No, real transformation of cause into effect, try to understand this way, that when we make curd from the milk, milk changes into curd. And when milk changes into curd, it is the transformation of milk into curd. So it is a type of Prakriti, transformation of Prakriti into different objects. It is a real transformation. It is not that it is appearing. I am seeing that the milk has become curd. And then the philosophy of Sankhya establishes that every object is the actual transformation of Prakriti into the particular of effect. Every effect is coming like that. Now, this Satkaryavad has been given or understood in two ways. One says that everything has come from Prakriti. And whatever we are seeing, this is seen as water bottle. The water bottle has been taken, it's safe from a particular type of iron seat or something like that, and it has been given this seat. And whatever is this one, this is the real transformation of that earlier form of this into this form. So it is a real transformation of the object from which it has been created, and it is not that one. It has been created, and now that what is created is a new one. It is coming to us. It is the real transformation of that, of its cause into the effect. But this Satkaryavad is also known as Brahma Vivartavad. And this is a philosophy from Vedanta, especially Shankaracharya. He says that yes, Brahma is the only reality. And whatever the world of objects which we are seeing in this whole world, they are only the appearance of Brahma. We know it by different names. We have given it different names, but they are nothing but Brahman. And therefore they say that it is the appearance of Brahma in different effects. So Brahma is the only reality, and different effects are only the appearance of the different object. They are not reality. So they called Brahma Vivartavad. So both are Satkaryavad. The effect, cause exists, and this cause has potentiality to produce the effect. The effect according to Sankhya is the real transformation, whereas according to Vedanta it is only the appearance of the cause into effect. These are very, very philosophical understanding. This pen or laptop or mobile, whatever you see. But along with that, there is another theory which says that everything is a new creation. It was not that effect existed in the cause. Whatever the effect I am seeing in this world is all a new creation, and therefore it is not accepted that effect exists in the cause. Of course cause is there, but when cause is taking a new form and new object comes into existence, it is a new beginning of the thing. Just as I am my existence in this world, I was not before I was created. And the philosophy says, this is a special philosophy known as Nyaya philosophy, they say no, you were not here, you were in the parents, and parents have created you. Before your creation you were not there, your creation is a new creation. So in this way there are the different types of theory of cause and effect. Sankhya believes, now coming to the Sankhya, Sankhya says every object of the world has come from Prakriti, number one, and every object of the world is the real transformation of Prakriti into different objects, and therefore it is the transformation of Prakriti into objects. Now I'm giving the example of the all three, just a very simple example. I've already explained to you. Now the first thing that I have said, I had given you the example of milk and curd. Here I have made the example, pot was there in the mud. A potter creates pot from a particular mud. Now that pot cannot be created unless the mud has the ability to transform itself into the pot. That is, mud has the ability to be given a shape of the pot. Every mud cannot be given the shape of the pot. Every wood cannot be made transformed into the table. Everything has its... So it says that before we make a table, the table in the wood is implicit. And table is only the explicit form of the table which was implicit in the wood. Or it is said that every effect is a development which is enveloped in the cause. So whatever the effect I am getting in the form of oil, it is already there in the oil seed. So it says that if there would not have been oil in the oil seed, can we get oil? We cannot get oil. Can we get oil from the sand? No, we cannot get oil from the sand. We can get oil only from this oil seed. It suggests that the effect exists in its cause. If effect is not there in the cause, how the effect could have taken place from the cause? We cannot produce anything from anything. Only a particular effect can be produced from a particular cause. And for this reason, they say that effect exists in the cause. And the effect is the real transformation of the cause into effect. Now the second point that I had given, that is the philosophy given by Nyaya. It said pot is a new beginning. Oil is a new beginning. It may be there in the oil seed, but when I get the oil, oil is a new beginning. In the same way, when the pot is made from the mud, pot is a new beginning for the mud. It is wrong to say that it was there in the mud. Can mud give the purpose of the pot? Can the oil seed give the purpose of the oil that we are using? Can the milk give the purpose of the curd? So curd is a new beginning, pot is a new beginning, oil seed is a new beginning. Every effect that we are getting around is a new beginning. Unless it is transformed in that way with some efficient cause. But you know that Vivartavad that I have just already given, it says that what we see as pot or mud, it is all but Brahman. So you see, when we see this rope as a snake, rope is there, we consider it to be snake, but it is nothing but rope. In the same way, we consider this pot, but actually nothing but it is Brahman. So every object is Brahman. It goes to the extent of saying, my name is Sahai, I am also a Brahman. You call me by name Sahai, but I am not Sahai, I am Brahman. So Vedanta philosophy will say everything is Brahman. We call it water bottle, it is Brahman. We call it laptop, it is Brahman. We give different names for the empirical world, for our use in this world, but not that they are really existing. Existing is only Brahman. All other are only appearance. Now let us try to understand how Prakriti is the root cause. The whole world of object is a creation, and the cause from which they have come must be potentially capable of creating them. The whole world of objects, and when we say world of objects, do not isolate yourself from the world. We are also the part of the world. So including me and including every object of the world that is being seen, they are also a creation, and the cause from which they have been created are potentially capable of creating. If they are not potentially capable of creating, they cannot create this world of objects. If I say Prakriti is the root cause of all the world objects that has come into existence, it means that Prakriti must be having the potentiality to create. If Prakriti is not having the potentiality, how Prakriti can be said to have been created or have evolved in the different objects of the world? Prakriti has the potentiality according to Sankhya philosophy. Now he wants to prove that why I am saying that Prakriti has the potentiality. All these are there in the uncaused form. We'll have to accept that Prakriti is uncaused. Now see, if I say that Prakriti, everything is coming from the Prakriti, then the question may be asked that who is the creator of Prakriti? So when Prakriti, I am saying that Prakriti is root cause, somebody may ask, okay, where from this Prakriti has come? But if you ask this, where from this Prakriti has come, the next question will also ask. If I say from X Prakriti has come, then your question will be that from where the X has come? If I say somebody Y has come from X, Y is the root cause for the X, and from X Prakriti has come, then you can ask what is the cause of Y? Philosophy says we will have to stop somewhere. Otherwise it will lead to the state of or question of ad infinitum or infinite regress. So is the case. Now when we are talking about this Prakriti, we have to stop somewhere. Prakriti, when it is able to solve your problem, why you are trying to find out the cause for that? Let us try to understand that Prakriti is all capable of solving your problems of the objects of the world that has been created. We can say that yes, Prakriti is the root cause. In order to prove it is undoubtedly necessary that what exactly Prakriti is. What is this Prakriti? It is very interesting. You know that everything is called Prakriti. And what is this Prakriti? Prakriti is the state of equilibrium of three gunas. You have heard the name of Sattva, Raj and Tama. Sattvic, Rajasic, Tamasic. We are using these words very commonly. Oh, he is a very sattvic person. Oh, he is a very tamasic person. We sometimes condemn the person. Oh, he is a tamasic person. He is condemned. And we say, oh, he is a very rajasic person. light way we are, and when we are seeing some person very nicely talking and very nicely taking care and always very compassionate, and then we say, oh, he's a very sattvic person. So we differentiate the people on the basis of sattvic, rajasic and tamasic. All the objects of the world can be classified as sattvic, rajasic and tamasic. Sattva, rajas and tamas. Sankhya says that Prakriti actually is nothing but the balanced state of sattva, raj and tama. So what we call Prakriti, if we say that balanced state of sattva, rajas and tamas, it will also reflect to, or it will also give the meaning of Prakriti only. So the balanced state of three gunas, either we say this thing or we say Prakriti, are the same. There is no difference. They are the constraints of Prakriti, and though and through it of the worldly objects. Because we are knowing they are constraints of Prakriti, means Prakriti is not different from these three gunas. So we should not say, this is a very interesting point, and always be careful. We should not say Prakriti has three gunas. If Prakriti has three gunas, it means that Prakriti has some other existence and Prakriti contains or has, is having three gunas in it. No, other than three gunas, there is nothing like Prakriti. So Prakriti is the name given to it when the three gunas are in balance condition. And why say they say the balance condition? Because when they are in balance condition, there is no creation. With the objects of the world that we are seeing around are actually not the Prakriti, because they are created. So what is there? Whenever there is the creation, we call it Vikriti. When we say that Vikriti, Vikriti is named for the effect. Every effect is the Vikriti of Prakriti. Every effect is the Vikriti of the cause. And every effect is having all the three gunas in it. This water bottle is having three gunas. My house is having three gunas. This mobile is having three gunas. Every object is having three gunas. We cannot separate them. Now, they are called gunas because they are intertwined. We should not say gunas have the qualities. Gunas have certain characteristics. Guna is sattuguna. What is the sattuguna? Sattuguna has some characteristic. Rajuguna, rajuguna has some characteristic. So they are not qualities in themselves. They contain qualities. So guna should not be translated as quality. They should be only translated as the primordial concept of Prakriti. And that's the only sattuguna. Then undoubtedly we will have to explain what the sattuguna is. Sattuguna stands for. What for this rajaguna stands? What for this tamoguna stands? And when you will try to explain that rajaguna has these qualities, so rajaguna has the qualities. Rajaguna itself is not having the quality. It is only guna. Guna has the quality. Guna has the characteristics. And they are called guna, that is because, this is very interesting, that it is like that they are intertwined. The ladies are using usually the three layers of when they make the intertwining of their own hair. They are intertwined in the same way, just having to make up the rope. And therefore, they are just like rope. And rope is the right word for this, because these gunas are fundamentally working as rope for binding us in this world. We are bound in this world because of this rope, because of this Prakriti, and because of this three gunas. And rope, because it has bound us, because they are not allowing us to be free. That which binds Purusha is called guna. That's why it is known as rope. I have told you the three gunas. These three gunas are sattva, rajas and tamas. Let us try to understand first. You know that in Sankhya Karika, in one Karika, Ishwar Krishna has explained all the three gunas. And that Karika is, I'm just reading that Karika, it says, Sattvam Lagu Prakasakam Ishtam Upastambakam Chalam Charaja Guru Avaranaka Tama Deepavat Chartato Vritteha. Sattvam Lagu Prakashakam Ishtam. There are three qualities of Sattva. Sattvam is Lagu, Sattvam is Ishtam, and that is Prakashakam also. It is called goodness. It produces pleasure. It produces happiness. It produces lightness to the body. And it is bright. It is buoyant. It is illuminating. It has the quality of reflection. It can reflect. If we are able to see our face in the mirror, because it is having the sattvic quality, and when the mirror is not projecting your figure, it means that it is lacking sattvic quality. So sattvic is called goodness, produces pleasure, it is light, bright, buoyant, illuminating, it is also pleasurable, luminosity of light, power of reflection, upward movement, pleasure, happiness, contentment, bliss are all due to it. Its color is white. You know, usually whenever we see the white color, we say, oh, it is very good, soothing, so nice, so white, sattva, that gives pleasure to you. So the gifts is known as white color. Everything that gives you pleasure in this world is sattva. That which gives, but depending on your happiness also can have a different subjective. So I will be coming on that point as well. It's because happiness can be got even through other means. Now there is rajas. Rajoguna is a guna which is active in itself. And not only that it is active in itself, it has the quality to activate others. So it is active itself and it is also stimulating others. And that's why the two words that has been given in the Sankhya philosophy, it says that it is chalam upastambakam cha. Upastambak means that which can stimulate, which can give motion to the others, which can make you more active, and it is itself also active. It really means foulness and is the principle of motion. It produces pain. It is also restless activity. It produces pain, restless activity, feverish effort, wild stimulation. It is highly active and the quality to activate others. Its quality, its color is red and it is giving pain. It is called Rajagun. Whatever, I will be giving little more time. I will take more time to explain this. Not only this much. I'm just going through the how this Sankhya philosophy presents it. Now tamas. In order to understand tamas, simply make it opposite of sattva. When you make the opposite of sattva, you get the tamas. It means darkness. That which is light is sattva. That which is tamas is the principle of inertia. It produces apathy and indifference, ignorance, sloth, confusion, bewilderment, passivity, negativity are the results of tamas. It is heavy and enveloping. Enveloping means it covers the reality. It obstructs the vision. If you are unable to see something and it is not clear to you, it means that you are under the grip of tamas. and because of the grip of tamas, either your eyes, you are under the grip of tamas, or the object that you are willing to see is under the grip of tamas. That way, both the possibilities are there. So you may be a sattugun, but the object in itself is tamas, it will not be seen. So it is enveloping. It is opposite of sattuguna. And it is opposed of rajas, as it arrests activity. Its color is dark, as against the white. So the sattva is white, rajas is red, and tamas is black. And it is heavy against sattva, which is light. It is enveloping against the sattva, which is buoyant and which is illuminating. So these are the two opposite type of the thing that you find in sattva and tamas. Very interestingly, do not forget that I have given you the concept of rajas, which is given only the concept of pain. But more than that, the quality of rajas has been given as the mobility, has the ability to move, and also has the ability to give movement to the others. It means that the sattva and rajas, tamas, are in themselves are not having the ability to move. This movement ability is supplied by rajas. So rajas is supplying the ability of movement to the sattugun. This rajas is also applying ability of movement to the tamagun. These three gunas constitute prakriti. They are continuously under the conflict, yet they cooperate. It is very interesting. I read one verse from Karika. I said that sattvam lagu prakasakam istam upastambakam chalam charajah guru avaranakam tamah pradeepavat charthato vritte. They are doing their action like that of a earthen lamp. Earthen lamp, you might have seen a pot. And you see the pot, which is made up of the clay. You put the oil in it, and you put a wick in it, and light it. So compared to the oil, wick and flame of a lamp, they are something like that. They cooperate with each other. Light, oil, wick and flame, they are the three things. And they cooperate, therefore we get the light. If they don't cooperate, we will not get the light. If there is too much oil in the wick, again the light will not come. It will not be burning. So all the balance is there in order to get the light. It means that the gunas also work in us in the same way. We get the light because they are balancedly working in us. And we are made up of these three gunas. The gunas are imperceptible. We cannot see the prakriti. Because if the gunas are in their balanced condition, they remain imperceptible. And they are only inferred. We can infer about them from their effects. All things are composed of these three gunas, and their differences are due to difference of the proportion of gunas. It is very interesting why we say that all objects are coming from prakriti. If we say all objects are coming from prakriti, it means that all objects are having all the three gunas. We cannot say that a particular object has only sattugun, a particular object has only tamagun, particular object has only rajogun. No. It says that all the three gunas are always remaining with every object that is produced. And that's why we say that they are coming from prakriti. And that's why no object of the world, including our existence, is devoid of any particular guna. Of course, there is a dominance of the particular guna. So try to understand. So object is also having the dominance of the gunas, and the perceiver, the person who is using them or trying to see them, they are also having the dominance of gunas. If I am having the dominance of rajogun, my perception will change accordingly, and we will see the objects in my own way according to the dominance of guna in me. If I am having the tamoguna, my perception will be like that only. If I am having the sattuguna, my perception towards the object will be the same. That's why it is said that every object is being assessed on the basis of the which guna is dominant in you. Object is having all the three gunas and capable of producing all the three as results. But depending on which of guna is dominating in me, we try to understand the object. A very unique and very popular example for this particular concept is given with the rose flower. Now see, the rose flower is one. And if this rose flower is presented to a young boy, young person, young girl, seeing that rose flower, they become happy. It gives happiness to them. Now this happiness is produced because of the sattuguna dominated in the person who is seeing it. And also, since sattuguna is there in the rose, therefore it is able to give the result or give the effect of happiness. Now the same rose flower is given to a person who is on deathbed. Will he be happy to see the rose flower? He will be pained. He will see that rose flower and say, oh, I will not be there to see the flower again because I am on death, I am dying. And the same rose flower give pain to him. Why it is giving pain? Because rose flower has got the rajogun also in it. And the person who is having dominance of rajoguna at each time. And that's why they are able to get the effect of pain. But try to think of the person who is looking after the garden where the rose are being grown. He is seeing the rose flower every day. He is seeing the rose flower every day, and it is being plucked and being sold in the market. It is a daily routine work that he is doing. Now the same rose flower, it is being seen by the person, he is indifferent. He is having no feeling of happiness or anything. He will say, okay, I'm not saying any particular example. If you see in my own garden the rose flower, I become very happy. But think of the garden of the rose, where the rose flower is being grown in abundance, and there the rose flower is being grown by the person. He is a very indifferent person about the rose. It will neither give him pain nor give him happiness. And this condition also is possible because the rose has got the concept of tamogun in it. This only confirms that object has got all the three gunas. And then depending on the individual, either he is having dominated by sattugun or tamogun or rajogun, gets the effect of that particular object. For example, now I am taking it for any example. Take this laptop. I am working with this laptop. I know how to work, and I am getting a communication with all of you, and I am able to get the work done through it. It is giving me happiness. Oh, so nice. Laptop is so nice thing that I am taking the work from it. I know this work. But suppose when the laptop stopped working and no audio was there, it started giving pain. You can imagine, the same laptop is not giving happiness all the time. It can give pain also. And also, you know that I'm using the laptop. I know to use the laptop, and it gives me pain and pleasure both. But for a third person who does not know what is laptop, one and the same object is capable of giving all the three effects. And it is true for each and every object of the world. And it, you only think that you have to apply it. But when you apply, you will find that yes, it is this case. There is not a single object is there which are not having all the three gunas. And since every object of the world is having all the three gunas, therefore it has been concluded by Sankhya philosophy that all the three gunas, since they are there in the object, they are coming from the same source, and the source should have all the three gunas in it, and therefore they are coming from Prakriti, because Prakriti has all the three gunas. And it must be, because there is no other possibility, because this is the way that we should understand the Sankhya philosophy. Sankhya philosophy is that philosophy which considers that each and every object, and it is not true of the object, now coming to the person, it is true for the human being also, we people. I am loved by somebody, I am hated by somebody, I am remaining indifferent for somebody. Somebody is not, you can imagine, if for each and every person, each and every object, your house is there, my house is loved by me, the person who is not having this type of house is hating me, is jealous of me. And there are certain persons who are livid, what I have to do with this house, indifferent. Every object, I have got this pen is also having all the three gunas. I know how to write it, and when it is writing, I am happy with this. When it stops writing because there is no refill, it will give me pain. And the person who is working, the sweeper who is working in my house, for him it is nothing, and it will throw it out. He is indifferent for it. You take any example, any damn thing that you take around, and you will see that all the three gunas are there in it. On the basis of this, Sankhya philosophy has concluded that all the three objects, all the three gunas, are there in the objects that is produced, and since they are coming from one common source that is known as Prakriti, and this Prakriti has got all the three gunas in it, therefore we must say, and we have to accept and admit, that these effects have come from one common source which are having the potentiality to produce these things, and therefore they are coming from Prakriti, because Prakriti has all the potentiality. Thing. These gunas are imperceptible, and they are only inferred from their effects. All things are composed of these three gunas, and their differences are due to difference in the proportion of the gunas. Yes, proportion of the gunas are different. Sometime I am dominated by Sattugun, sometime I am dominated by Rajugun, sometime I am dominated by the Tamugun. When I am dominated by Sattugun, I see and I behave in a very good way. When I am dominated by the Rajugun, I become very harsh, very rough, very hard to think, and I may be abusing some person, I may be giving pain to the other person. And when I am under the grip of Tamugun, and when there is the dominance of Tamugun, I may go to sleep also. Heaviness. I don't want to talk with anybody. I just indifference. Let it be what is happening in the world. I have got no connection, no reference, and no any responsibility for that. So these are all different things. The nature of a thing is either good or bad or indifferent, intelligent, active or slothful, pure, impure or neutral, and these are due to the dominance of Sattva, Rajas and Tamas. You know that these gunas are always changing. When I say changing, it only means that they change also in the dominance. Sometime we are under the grip of Tamogun, sometime we are under the grip of Sattugun, sometime we are under the grip of Rajugun. Dominance is changed. And we cannot say that if suppose I am doing very good work, very good sadhana, very good meditation, and we say that, okay, I have completely removed Tamogun from my, and I am only Sattuguna. It cannot be like that. There is always Tamagun, existence of Tamagun and Rajagun is there, even if you have developed yourself to the extent that you have established the dominance of Sattugun in yourself. So even if you have established Sattuguna in yourself, they are there, they exist there, they may not be active there, but they are there. For this particular purpose, you know, I usually try to correlate this concept with that of the Ayurveda. And Ayurveda is having also the three components of the human existence, I mean, construction, constituents, and they are known as Vata, Pitta, and Kapha. And they are saying that Vata, Pitta, or Kapha is something like Sattva, Rajas, and Tamas. I disagree with them. I do not agree that Vata, Pitta, Kapha should be compared with the concept of Sattva, Rajas, and Tamas. Because you know, I don't know whether you have met any Ayurvedic person. If you go to the Ayurvedic person and he will examine you, and after examination, if he says you are a person of Vata Prakriti, or you are a person of Pitta Prakriti, or you are a person of Kapha Prakriti, you will remain Vata Prakriti, Kapha Prakriti, or Pitta Prakriti person throughout your life. You cannot change from Vata Prakriti to Pitta Prakriti. You cannot change yourself from Pitta Prakriti to Kapha Prakriti, because this is the fundamental nature of yours. This is not the case with the philosophy. If today you are a person from tamasic dominance, tomorrow you can transform yourself and become a sattvic person. If today you are a person of rajoguni, you can become a sattvic person, or you can become, if you are a person of sattuguna, you can become a tamoguni also. So downfall is also possible, and your elevation is also possible. There is nothing that you can maintain. So in yoga it is usually said, or in a spiritual path it is usually said, that if you are a good person, you have to be very careful to maintain your goodness. If you are not able to maintain your goodness, you are not able to maintain your sadhana, there is always a scope that your downfall will come. You will be again involved in the objects of the world. So if you are able, if you have withdrawn yourself from the objects of the world, you have to work with yourself and continuously with awareness. So it says that there are the two types of change. One is the homogeneous change, and there is the heterogeneous change. The heterogeneous change actually brings the evolution. Because when there is the dominance of the gunas, then there is the dominance of sattuguna, or when there is the dominance of rajuguna, when there is the dominance of tamoguna, they give rise to different type of objects. But there is a possibility of homogeneous change also. And homogeneous change will take place only when we work with the practice of yoga and sadhana, that homogeneous change will take place. Otherwise, homogeneous change will not take place. Homogeneous change means sattva and the objects of sattva going back to the sattva, rajoguna going back to the rajoguna, tamoguna going back to the tamoguna, and in this way going back to prakriti. So homogeneous change is the highest stage of your practice of sadhana. Otherwise, we are always under the grip of heterogeneous change. And this heterogeneous change has kept us always involved in the world, because there is either the dominance of sometimes sattuguna, or dominance of sometimes the tamoguna, or dominance of sometimes the rajoguna. When I am talking with this, please be careful one thing. Do not think that tamoguna and rajoguna are useless. They are not useful at all, and they should be completely removed, or they should never be given their proper status. And I am of the view that tamoguna and rajoguna are also equally necessary for our proper working in this world. If we are working in this world, we are able to work in this world because there is the tamoguna and rajoguna is there. If I am working, it means that rajoguna is there. If there is no activity, how can I work? If I am working, it means that rajoguna is helping me to work. So when I am speaking, the rajoguna is there, which is dominating also in me to work with it. And you know that tamoguna is also a very necessary thing. We may be thinking that tamoguna is a useless thing. It is not like that. Suppose the tamoguna is withdrawn from the existence. What will happen? You know that the earth has the power of This is called in Sanskrit and in Hindi, Gurutvakarshan. So gravity is keeping us intact. Suppose this gravity is withdrawn, what will happen to us? We will be floating in the air. If we are still maintaining, I am able to sit here and sit on the chair and able to talk with you, it is because of the tamogun that I am able to sit on the chair. If tamogun is withdrawn, again this, we will not be able to sit on the chair. We will be feeling as if we are floating, because sattvagun is there, rajagun is there, we are moving. So do not consider that one guna is inferior, other guna is superior. It is only with a purpose for which we are working. From that point of view, one guna is inferior and another guna is superior. But not usually for our general existence, they are not inferior or superior. They are all required. A person is able to sit and do meditation. It is all because there is the tamoguna is there. The rajoguna is there, the sattvaguna is there. Every guna is required. So take it in from us that the Sankhya philosophy, when it talks about the three gunas as the root of all the objects of the world, he wants to say that because of or without these three gunas, the evolution and the functioning of the whole world would not have taken place if we would not have given the proper importance to these three gunas. You know that the Sankhya philosophy has tried to give, and it salutes the Prakriti. And in one of the verse, Karika, it says that Ajam Ekam Lohit Sukla Krishnam Bahuvi Praja Srijamanam Namamah. I salute Prakriti. I salute Prakriti because it is unborn. It is not cause, effect of anything. And since it is not effect of anything, it is Ajam, unborn. What type of color it is having? It is having Lohit Sukla Krishnam. It is having the red, white and black color. And also it Bahuvi Prajaha Srijamanam, it produces many objects in the world and also nurses it just like a mother of all generations. Now comes the second reality. I have talked about the first reality now. I am coming to the second reality, and the second reality is also known as Purusha. Purusha is usually translated as soul, self, spirit, subject, knower. It is the ultimate knower. It is known as self. It is known as soul. Although the word Atma is also used for Purusha, I have not written that. So there are certain, I'm not going into the philosophical dispute of different words, but take it as common understanding, that is the soul, self, spirit, subject, knower, and also the Atman are one and the same. And they are co-present. It is along with Prakriti, is always co-present. It is eternal realities. So one of the eternal reality is Prakriti, and the other eternal reality is the Purusha. Purusha is neither the body, it is also not the senses, it is also not the brain, not the memory, not the ego, not the intellect. So Purusha is different from the body, different from senses, different from brain, different from memory, different from ego, different from mind, different from intellect. It is also not a substance which possesses the quality like consciousness. Do not think that Purusha is having the consciousness or possesses the quality of consciousness. No, it is not possessing the quality of consciousness. Rather, it is consciousness itself. It is nothing but consciousness. This pen has ink. It means that pen is there and ink is there inside. It is not like that with the Purusha. Purusha is only consciousness. It is pure consciousness. as essential thing. It is ultimate knower. It is pure subject. It is witnesser, ever emancipated, neutral seer. And it is called Nistraigunya. I have already said that Prakriti is having the three gunas, or it is nothing but its balanced state of three gunas. Where it must be something which is beyond the three gunas. This is a very interesting point. Let us try to understand it in this way. Can pen see itself? Can this water bottle can use itself? There must be somebody, some intelligent one to use this water bottle. Can this water bottle use itself? Can this laptop use itself? There must be somebody to use this laptop. Can this mobile use itself? And all these are the objects of Prakriti. Now, logically it leans to the concept that objects of Prakriti cannot be enjoyed by Prakriti itself. There must be some else, someone else, some different, which is beyond the Prakriti. If it is in Prakriti, it means that it can't see itself. So something which is beyond the Prakriti is called Purusha. So Prakriti requires someone to enjoy the object that it has produced. And it should be other than Prakriti, other than the realm of Prakriti. So we have to accept, yes, there is a concept like Purusha, which is undergoing the concept of enjoying, seeing the objects, and Prakriti is being seen. The whole of the creation will have no meaning if there is nobody who can see it. If a person is inventing something, if you are creating something, you want that something that I have created should be used by somebody. If nobody is there to use, your creation has got no meaning. If we have created something, for example, I am giving you a very unique example. If I know something, if I have not a listener, my knowing is having no value. I want a listener. Prakriti expresses, manifests itself in different objects. Unless and until Prakriti is being seen by somebody, is being enjoyed by somebody, its whole creation is useless. The Purusha is that which is experiencing, enjoying, and yet it is, and also it is beyond the three gunas. This is very interesting. You know that in the Indian philosophy there is monism. Monism means there is only one reality. I have said in the beginning itself. Pluralism means there are many realities. Dualism means there are only two realities. This is very interesting. Fundamentally, Purusha, so far as qualitative consideration is there, all Purushas are having the same quality. So there is qualitative monism. All the Purushas are having the same quality. But when the aspect of quantity is concerned, there are many Purushas. And you know that every Purusha is striving and aspiring for its liberation. You are aspiring for liberation, I am aspiring for liberation, everybody is aspiring for liberation. But once liberation, if you are successful in getting liberation, does not mean that I will also get liberation. My soul, my Purusha will have to aspire, work upon ourselves and have to get liberation. So once liberation does not mean everybody's liberation. Therefore, Sankhya says that each Purusha is different and each Purusha has to work for its own liberation. And from that point of view, there are as many Purushas as there are species. So we have the several types, many Purushas. Bliss is also not the essence of Purusha. It is only the consciousness. Because so far as bliss is concerned, bliss is the quality of Sattva-guna. And that which comes under the Sattva-guna becomes the Prakriti, not the Purusha. As it is the product of Sattva-guna. if the self were one, bondage of one self would mean bondage of all, and liberation of one would have mean liberation to all. The activity of one would mean activity by all. So therefore, we are different, and everyone is different. You are different, I am different, every person is different. Every person is aspiring for its own liberation, and their own liberation aspiration will result in liberation, and it is only for oneself. And therefore, from that point of view, this philosophy believes in a very individualistic approach. Your sadhana is for you, not for me, not for my fellow being. And accordingly, we are doing the sadhana. So, from where we have come, if we know, then we also know where we have to go. And therefore, they are always trying to inquire, first of all, from where we have come, how these things have come in this world, how the objects of the world came into existence. And when we know the reality behind how these objects have come into existence, then we also will be able to know that where we have to go backward. This is the condition, this is the position that we are having. Now, Prakriti is essentially regarded as dynamic. It is always moving. So, although I have said that Prakriti is the state of equilibrium of the gunas, but this equilibrium is not there all the time. It is, equilibrium is very subjective. If you get liberation, for you, Prakriti stops moving. If I get liberation, I get every concept. When I am liberated, Prakriti stops moving for me. Moving for me means Prakriti stops creating for me. Prakriti stops manifesting for me. And Prakriti stoppage of manifestation, stoppage of creating means that there is the balance of the gunas. So you have to attain the balance of the gunas so that you are no more involved in the world. Till the Prakriti is creating, we are involved in the world. It says that when there is heterogeneous change in Prakriti, there is evolution. Here comes the answer to the question, what is heterogeneous? Heterogeneous change means when there is one guna tries to overpower the other guna. And in this way, sometimes Rajaguna tries to overpower the Sattva and Tama. Tama tries to overpower the Sattva and Rajas. Rajas tries to overpower the Sattva and Tama. When they try to overpower each other, then there is the creation. And therefore, the whole object that we find in this world are the result of the heterogeneous change in the Prakriti. And they are all having the dominance of one guna or other guna. There are many things that you find the sattva guna, but sattva guna also can transform itself into tamaguna. If you drink one glass of juice, it is sattvic, so nice, giving you happiness. Drink the second glass, again it may be very blissful, very nice. But if you go on drinking and drink the six glasses, on the seventh glasses you will feel that no, it is a punishment, I don't want. This become tamoguni. Try to understand, one and the same juice which worked as sattva guna has become tamoguna. Everything, every object is having all the three gunas, depending on different situation. Sattva, the principle of manifestation, Rajas, the principle of activity, is held balanced by tamas, principle of non-manifestation and non-activity. When rajas vibrates and makes other two also vibrate, the process of evolution begins. Let us try to understand through this one example. I take the example of in one room, there are three persons sharing the one room. These three persons are having three different type of qualities. One person is there who goes to bed at 9:30 and gets up at 5 in the morning. It is his daily routine. He goes to the bed at 9:30 and gets up at 5 a.m. in the morning. He is living that life in that room. The other person, he goes to bed at 8 p.m. and gets up at 9 a.m. It is his way of life. He goes to bed at 8 p.m. and gets up at 9 a.m. There is a third person also in the room, and that person is restless in the whole night. He is not getting sleep. Now, when he becomes too much restless, what he will try? He will start trying disturbing the other two. When he start disturbing other two, who will be the first person to respond to his disturbance? Undoubtedly, the person who goes to bed at 9:30 and gets up at 5 p.m. will be the first person to respond to that disturbance. Not the person who goes to bed at 8 p.m. and gets up at 9 a.m. But when this person will respond, after that, the tamoguna, rajoguna will also try to disturb the tamoguna, and tamoguna also gets disturbed and it also wakes up. Now see the example. This example is actually the example for the creation that has started. Rajoguna, I am saying restless because it is the principle of restlessness. Because it is principle of restlessness, it is making restless other two also. But even out of these two, the first, the sattuguna, it becomes restless or makes it disturbed. And after making disturbed the sattuguna, it disturbs the rajoguna, tamoguna also. In this way, all these three become disturbed. Evolution takes place in this way. Creation according to theory of Satkarja was not a new creation, but only their manifestation. But according to Sankhya, this equilibrium of Prakriti is disturbed because of its union with Purusha. You know, this is very interesting, but Sankhya believes that they are the two opposite principles, they do not meet. So if they do not meet, how there is the possibility of union? So how union can result into disturbance? Because when there is no union, there is no possibility of disturbance in Prakriti. These two are entirely different and separate. If they are separate, they cannot unite. You know, for this thing, although it is very difficult to make how this disturbance in Prakriti might have happened, let us try to take another example. Or have you been ever to a bungalow? On the gate of it, there is no anything caution written that beware of dogs. It is only the gate. You open the gate and from distance you are seeing the dog is there and it is sleeping. From distance you are seeing the dog is there and it is sleeping. What will be the chemical change in you? Will there be chemical change in you or not? There will be chemical change. And a fear for the sake of dog will be there in you. Now, how much dog is responsible for this fear? It is sleeping. It is not disturbing you at all. Yet there is the change in your, in a chemical change in yourself. It is something like that, that Purusha is always near Prakriti but not united. And Purusha is being seen by Prakriti. And because the Purusha is being seen by Prakriti, there is the disturbance in Prakriti. In the same way as we are getting disturbance or disturbed or having chemical change in us by seeing the dog from distance. And when it gets disturbed, now on the basis of the example of the three persons that I have given you, you can understand that which guna will be disturbed first. Rajoguna will be disturbed first. And when Rajoguna will be disturbed first, what it will do? It will disturb the Sattuguna first. And in this way, the first evolute that we find in, or we find through, coming through the Prakriti, is known as intelligence or Mahat. Mahat, the great germ or intellect. and it is produced as a result of disturbance in sattva. And since it is produced with the disturbance in sattva, first of all, therefore it has dominance of sattva-guna. You know that intelligence always has the dominance of sattva-guna. Intelligence always gives us the right direction, right way to think. Its original attributes are virtues, knowledge, detachment, power of reflection. We have the sattva-guna fundamentally. If you make your meditation and talk with your own self, talk with your intellect will give you always the right direction, what to do and what not to do. But only thing is that our ego comes in the middle, and our ego so overpowers this intellect, and we come under the grip of tamoguna. And then we forget what intellect is saying. We try to impose our own thought on the intellect. And then intellect under the grip of tamoguna is supporting whatever you are. But fundamentally, intellect always gives the right direction. But when it is, that's why it is written, when it gets vitiated by tamoguna, these attributes are replaced by the opposites. Memories and reflection are stored. Mahat, you know that mahat has been produced, product is the result of the production of dominance of sattva-guna. And because it is produced as a result of the dominance of sattva-guna, and because of the nearness of the purusa, purusa gets reflected in mahat. Purusa gets reflected in ahanka, in intellect. When it gets reflected in intellect, what happens? It starts seeing itself in the intelligence. And since it starts seeing itself in intelligence, then comes the ego. Although this ego is not having the consciousness, but mere by the reflection, it gets a feeling of consciousness in itself. And because of that, I told you that ego is not a pure consciousness, it is only a pseudo-consciousness. Purusa gets wrongly identified with this and considers itself as an agent of all the actions, desirer of desires, and possessor and enjoyer of ideas and emotions. Ego further gives, because of the ego, because you know that ego is not sufficient unless it gives production to the mind, unless it is also giving production to the sense organ, because ego without the sense organ cannot express itself. Ego without the mind cannot express itself. Ego without the motor organ cannot express itself. I am going, I am listening, I am thinking, I am doing. Now all these things, ego is always, I is always expressed in relation with some motor organ, or in relation with some sense organ, or in relation with some in relation with mind. So viewed as cosmic production, manas, five organs and five motor organ, five sense organ and motor organ are produced as a sattvic dominance in ego. But there is the also tamas dominance, and viewed as cosmic produces five subtle elements, and from psychological point of view leads to indifferent acts or to idleness or the slothness. But when there is the rajogun dominance, viewed as cosmic, it supplies energy to the sattvic and tamasic both. So rajogun is there when it is giving production to the sattvic dominance thing, or when it is giving production to the tamasic dominance things. It is available to both, and viewed as psychological, it leads to evil deeds. Now see the whole creation, how it has come. This is the creation that has come. Purusha and Prakriti being near, this is the process of evolution. Purusha and Prakriti being near, Prakriti gets disturbed in the way that I have given you the example. And the first thing that comes is the Mahat. Mahat being very pure in it, Mahat being having this dominance of the Sattva-guna, reflects the Purusa in itself. And because of the reflection, there comes the Ahankar, ego. Ego has got either the dominance of Sattva-guna or dominance of Tamaguna. As a result of the dominance of Sattva-guna, there is the production of Manas. There the production of the five sense organs known as sight, smell, taste, touch and sound. And there is also the production of five motor organs, and these motor organs are speech, apprehension, movement, excretion and reproduction. These are the five motor organs. But as a result of the five tamogun, there comes the essence of sound, essence of touch, essence of color, essence of taste and essence of smell. These are the essence, and because of these essence, there comes the production of the five gross elements, which are known as ether, air, fire, water and earth. From essence of sound comes the ether, from essence of touch comes the air, from essence of color comes the fire, from essence of taste comes the water, and from essence of smell comes the earth. And in this way, if you just count, there are total 25 elements that are enumerated and produced by Prakriti, fundamentally. Rest of the objects that are seen in the world are only the combination permutation of all these things. So there is no need to further enumerate of all the objects. What are those objects that come as the result of the combination permutation? These are the fundamentals. How to get the liberation? Liberation consists in realizing the self is totally different from the element or the objects of Prakriti, and it is never associated with Prakriti. Well, it is very difficult. It consists, I have said in sentence very easily, that liberation consists in realizing the self. But is it easy? Can I see that if I am having this water bottle with me here, if somebody takes the water bottle, I will immediately ask, no, bring this water bottle. I am associated with it. I am living in this house. I am associated with this house. I never think that I can live without this house. The problem is that we are so much associated and attached with the objects of the world that we never think that our existence is possible without these objects. We never think that I can exist without my wife. We never think that I can exist without my son. I never think that I can exist without my grandson or the house or anything like that. We are so much attached to the objects. But this is very interesting, and we must not forget, our attachment is one-sided. We are attached. Objects are not attached with me. It is our attachment that always compels and binds me in this world. We think that, okay, I am attached to my wife. My wife is also equally attached to me. No, it may not be the case. I am attached to this water bottle, but water bottle is not attached to me. I am attached to this house, but this house is not attached to me. So my attachment is always one-sided attachment. And that's why it says that if you can realize that your attachment is one-sided, and then you can withdraw yourself. Only problem is that it is very difficult to believe that my attachment is one-sided. We forget this concept. We are always knowing that, and that's why I usually say that we have caught the tree, and we are also crying that tree is not leaving me. We have caught the objects of the world, and we are crying that I am unable to leave the world. You know that a two lovers, they also speak with each other, lover and beloved, they are speaking, oh, without you I can't live. But after that, nobody goes with him. It is one person who dies and the other person remains. It is all just words. We have come alone and we will go alone. We have developed our attachment here in this world, and this attachment is one-sided, not both-sided. And when we are understanding this thing, there comes the homogeneous change in the Prakriti. Heterogeneous change is the result of is the thing that all objects come into manifestation, come into creation. But when there is homogeneous change, the the five gross elements return to the five subtle elements, the motor organ, the sense organ, the manas return to the ego, ego return to the mahat, and mahat return to the prakriti. It is homogeneous change. Go back. So homogeneous change happens only when we start going back, not otherwise. This is what, and for them, once you have gone back, once you have realized what is prakriti, prakriti stops dancing. Dancing means it stops manifesting, it stops creating. And in the final slide, I am giving you one couplet from Bihari, a great poet in Hindi. I don't know whether you have heard the name of Bihari. Bihari was a Hindi poet whose one verse gives a lot of meaning. It says that satsaya ke dore arunavik ke teer dekhan mein chote lage ghav kare gambhir. These couplets are very small, but they are having very deeper meaning. It says amiya halahal madvare set syam ratnar jiyat marat chuki chuki parat jai chitvat ekbar. It says that amiya, that is known as nectar, halahal, that is known as poison, and madvare, that is known as intoxicating. They are having the three colors. Amiya is the white, halahal is the black, and madvare is the red. And they are having the special effect. Jiyat, because of the amrit, marat, because of the poison, and madvare, intoxicating, there is juki juke prat, intoxicating effect. Jahi chitvat, it has been said about the prakriti. Once prakriti sees, these are the three effects that come. We should be careful and understand this thing. I stop it here. I am giving my thanks from my heart. Thank you very much.